Please reply in the chat box if I am audible and visible. Yes, great. Okay, so I welcome all of you to this prelims cracker masterclass, this series of webinars that you're having on different subjects. And today, as you all of you know, that it's on ancient and medieval history, which is like a very, very scary area of UPSC prelims, something that aspirants these days dread. So we are going to discuss some hacks, some tips, some trends, just to make the thing easy for you. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, all of you. Manjunath, Samantak, Rahul, Sagar, everybody, good afternoon. So, okay, great. So without much delay, I'll quickly start with the session. Kindly enable the screen sharing. Okay, great. Great. So can you see my screen now, everybody? Screen is great. Great. Okay. So today we are going to do a quick trend analysis of ancient and medieval history, previous year questions, previous year questions have come starting from mostly this difficult trend of ancient and medieval history. Ancient and medieval history became a very difficult area, something very hard, a hard nut to crack. All these things started from your 2017-18 this time. So we have mostly tried to analyze this, where we have taken up questions from this period, and I've tried to analyze some kind of pattern. I've tried to decode some kind of pattern so that it gets easier for you people. So I'll start. Before that, starting from 2018 to 2021, we'll have a glance at the number of questions average each year that you have from your ancient and medieval history. So if you see 2018, there were roughly around 5 to 6 questions, which increased to 10, 2020 also around 10. Now some will say it's from modern, some are from medieval. So that kind of ambiguity will be there. So we'll roughly keep it 10 to 12. 2021, it goes up to 12. So the number of questions is increasing, and it is certainly not less than 10. If you see from 2019 onwards, it is certainly not less than 10. So now if 10 to 12 questions come from ancient and medieval history, and you have another 8 to 10 questions from modern history, so then you can understand that what is the importance of ancient and medieval history. And for those people who are missing by a margin, you know, by just the borderline, so that one or two question actually makes a huge, huge difference. It decides your fate. So for that, we have just we'll start with a trend analysis. So the first thing that we're going to decode over the years, I'll tell you about the trend, and I'll show you how this trend is relevant, or how questions from these areas are coming. First trend that UPSC is trying to incorporate in its questions is chronology of events. Trend one is about your chronology of events or dynasties. So chronology means, see, in your chronology always remains a very important area. In history, you have to remember the chronology, otherwise history is irrelevant. But chronology as such was never important for UPSC. We always had this thing that, in UPSC, you don't need to mug up dates and events. Yes, still now it doesn't directly ask dates like your state PSC exams. But you have to take one step greater than that. You have to know dates, and you also have to be analytical about dates. You don't have to directly remember the dates. But here the dangerous thing is you don't have to remember that whether it was 14, Vasco da Gama came in 1498 or 1499. But you have to have an idea of the time period. You don't have to remember which year Timur attacked India, which year Nadir Shah attacked India. But what you have to remember is the time period. So if they ask a question that Nader Shah attacked India in the first half of the 17th century, or if they make it confusing and say that they Nader Shah attacked India in the second half of the 18th century, then you are in a fix. Then you don't know, if you don't know the exact date. So you have to know that Nader Shah attacked India somewhere between 1735 to 1740. Or rather 1730 to 1740. Even if you don't remember that it's 1739. Something like that. So this is where UPSC is becoming very, very difficult. And people who are doing well in their state PCS exams are cannot crack UPSC prelims. This is the reason. Because sometimes you mug up things and then you forget things. And then you don't understand, and this timeline kind of thing totally vanishes. So I will see one question, how this chronology is important. This was the question from 2020. Rise of Pratiharas under King Bhoja, establishment of Pallava power under Mahendra Varman, establishment of Chola power under Parantaka I, Pala dynasty founded by Gopala. Now Cholas came around 8th century, 8th to 10th, 11th, 12th century, they were there. So you know that Cholas were much later. Before that, you had your, you know, Pallavas and all these things. Now you might, so option three, you can obviously keep at the back that, okay, that was the last thing to happen. Pratiharas also, you are not sure who is the first Pratihara king. Or, you know, you don't know that Pallavas, okay, maybe Pallavas came earlier. So we can have Pallava. Now you're in a fix between whether it was Pallas first or Pallavas first or the Pratiharas first. So these kind of things, we are not dealing with elimination techniques in this session. So I will not discuss how to eliminate stuff, which to keep at the back, which how to guess, go for a 50-50 guessing. No, I'm not going to discuss that. I'm going to discuss your preparation strategy, because now you have a elimination technique and all that comes much later, just 1 week before your prelims. Just 1 month before your prelims. But now you have to focus on your preparation. So now you see that why chronology is important. Now you, what you have to study chronology in two ways. First, you have to know the chronology of dynasties, which dynasty came after whom, which part of which part of India they were ruling, whether they were in Northern India, Southern India, Eastern India, or which other part of India, who were each other's contemporaries. So when you're knowing about a particular dynasty, when you're reading about a particular dynasty, you have to know who were the contemporary dynasties, who were the contemporary dynasties of both in Northern India and in Southern India. And within the dynasty, you have to know what was the chronology. Now, if a dynasty has, say, 50 kings, it's not feasibly possible. And that's not even smart work that you read the names of 50 kings. And you are bound to forget. So each dynasty, if they have average around 30 to 40 kings, you will remember, mug up the names of 40 kings, because UPSC is making medieval and ancient history difficult. No, that's not the way to go about. So what you have to do is, you have to, what I suggest, you can make a you can take a paper, sheet of paper in landscape mode, an A4 size paper, and you can make a dynasty-wise chart. So the chart would probably have, and you have those clip folders where you stick your paper, like you attach your paper, and then you, so that before your exam or whenever you're revising, you flip through it. So when you make the chart would be like name of the king, name of the dynasty, most name of the dynasty, name of the king, what were his achievements, titles, if any, if battles, if he has fought any, then name of the battle with whom and which year. So you have to make a chart like this. Don't make it too big and too cumbersome. So this chart would mostly have each dynasty. You should make a chart dynasty wise. And each dynasty will have three things. First king, last king, most important king or kings. So among the most important, you might have a dynasty, might have 2 to 3 important kings, or maybe one, like Pallavas, there are 2 to 3 important kings, Cholas, 2 to 3 important kings. So you have to write their achievements. You have to write the battles they have fought, territories they have conquered, name of the territory, ancient name of the territory, and what is the modern name of the territory. That is, again, an important trend in UPSC. So you kind of have all of that information in one page. Temples, everything it has built, the king has built, all of that in small. Now, about the temple, don't make this this paper very cumbersome. Now, if you have some information about the temple, don't put it in this sheet of paper. Just write the name of the temple, built by which king, you have that. So when you next time when you're having your notes on culture, on art and culture, you write the name of the, you write about the temples, whatever information you have in your culture notes, you have information about the temple. Then you can write beside that name of the king and write that it is in so-and-so page of your history notes about that king. So because UPSC might have a ask a multi-statement question where you have, it starts with the, about say the Kandariya Mahadeva temple, like a question came in 2021. So the first question would be about, the first statement would be about the temple. Second statement would be about the dynasty, who built it. Third would be about some achievements of the king. So and so king fought of this dynasty, fought this battle. So you have to know about everything. You have to have integrated knowledge. But that doesn't mean that you make your notes cumbersome. It has to be very, very crisp, very smart. So that is how you can go about with chronology-based questions in ancient and medieval. Just a second, guys. Till this much, is it clear, everybody? Till this much, kindly reply in the chat box. Okay, yes. Okay, good. Good. Clear to everybody. So that's how you have to go about with your chronology-based questions and revision and re-revision and solving MCQs. There is no other way out. You have to revise again and solve MCQs. So this is one trend of your chronology-based questions. Next, we'll see another question. This is from 2021. From the decline of Guptas till the rise of Harshavardhan in the early 7th century, which of the following kingdoms? See, now this is about your second type of chronology. Just now I was talking about inter-dynasty chronology. Now see, which dynasty was ruling when? Who were the contemporaries? So this kind of chronology is also very important. Can you please summarize about the A4 sheet content? Yeah, I'll just do that. 5-time revision. Sahil, even 1-time revision is enough. 2-time revision is enough. Depends on your memory. Different people have different memory capacity. But I would suggest weekly revision and monthly revision. 5-time, 7-times. It all depends on your own capacity, my dear. Which source is best for that? Follow any source. Any source. Ancient, your NCRTs for your ancient and medieval. Current ones and old ones. Current ones are in a different pattern. Old ones, you will have this. Or any other book you're following, even that is fine. I will not suggest any book. This chronology, Tamil Nadu history books are very, very good about this chronology-based things. They have this king-wise, they have these things. So you can follow those as well. Give total strategy. I will be discussing strategies for each and every trend. Total strategy, I'll try to summarize it, but after each trend, how to go about with each trend, that I will tell you. So someone was asking about a summary of whatever this A4 sheet that I said. So this A4 sheet is like you take a A4 size paper and then you have to do this chronology, genealogy of kings or chronology, okay? So what you do is you take up one dynasty. You say you start with your dynasty, you take ancient India. You're starting with the Mauryas. Or more difficult ones are your medieval ones, starts from your, Mauryas, okay, more or less doable. Then starts your Satavahanas and then your Indo-Greek kings come. Then you have your, these Kushanas and the Shakas and all these things. So about ancient, then you have your medieval where you have your Palas and, Gujar Pratiharas and all your, that tripartite struggle, that part. Then you have the Harshavardhana, the time period after Harshavardhana, there were multiple kings. So how you go about this? You pick up a dynasty, you start, like for every dynasty have separate A4 sheet paper. So you pick up and write only on one side so that if you have additional notes from anywhere, you can put it on the other side. Make a star and put it on the other side. So you take up a piece of paper, horizontal A4 size paper, put it in landscape mode, draw columns. First column, name of the dynasty. King, name of the king. Achievements, wars fought, that would come under achievements. Titles, if the king had any kind of titles. Then it would be any architecture he has built or anything like that. So what you do is you put the name of the king, put the name of the dynasty, titles if he had like Maharaja Dhiraj or something extraordinary. Now every king more or less had Maharaja Dhiraj title. So you can just write it. Don't have to focus like on how many kings had Maharaja Dhiraj title or not. It was a very, very common title. So any special title anyone had, like Gangaikonda Cholapuram, I was named after the Chola kings who had defeated and they had captured this thing. So any special kind of title, if any, you know, these Pala kings had some kings like Shakrapan and all these things. They had these names for because they had destroyed the Hunas and all these things. So such kind of special titles, if any king have, try to focus on that. Use multicolor pens, make a box or, you know, put some kind of color so that it attracts your eye. So for that special title, the battles he has fought, with whom he fought the battle, which year, which place is also important. Try in your, make this from your basic history book. Now, as I said, temples he has built or any kind of other architecture he has built, where is this temple or anything located? When you go and revise, when you go to revise this sheet for the first time after you have made it, what you do is you also try to Google and write down that the battle he has fought. So for example, Darashikha fought the Battle of Dharmath. Where is Dharmath? They might ask a question. So you can just Google it up and just write down where is Dharmath. In your next reading, in the first reading, you do from your basic history book. For the second reading, you try looking up things that you have to Google. From that sheet, what are the things that you have to Google? You do that and your thing is done. And this A4 sheet, you keep on revising. For when once this is done, you don't have to read the genealogy of kings portion anymore from your history book. You will read your own notes again and again and again. That's the way to go about. And also you will write, if you're writing about, the Satavahana dynasty, then you have also write who were the contemporary dynasties. Satavahanas were ruling in Maharashtra, in the Latur area. So who were, they were of Malkher. So you have to write that who were the contemporary dynasties. Malkher is in which part of Maharashtra? Northern part, southern part, which part? Which area? If possible, you can draw a small map there. Which part of Maharashtra Malkher is? And who were the contemporaries in southern India, mostly in northern India also? So that's how you have to go about with your genealogy of kings. I hope that is clear. And next, you from this, see, contemporaries, dynasties, again, you can see there are very some important time periods. When it comes to genealogy of kings, see, UPSC prelims is an exam of elimination. So their aim is to confuse you. So they will confuse you from time periods where dynasties are multiple. One time period is after the Mauryas. There are some dynasties here and there, some people, intruders coming from Central Asia here and there. Post-Gupta. Gupta is a big period. Post-Gupta is again a time period of multiple dynasties. So this part becomes very, very important. Post-Gupta, it continues until Cholas, you know. Cholas are a big dynasty. Before that, you have a number of dynasties, Harshavardhana's time. Post-Harsha is another period where you have multiple dynasties. And, there was this thing that people would say that, okay, UPSC has some core areas and peripheral areas. I think 2020 and 2021's prelims, mostly 2021's prelims, have said that there's nothing called core and periphery in history, at least. So my advice would be that even dynasties of your Rajasthan, your Solankis and Parmars, which were least important, you cannot leave those as well. They might ask questions from there. So you cannot leave anything. But we have to go for a smart approach. You cannot go about reading every king. You have to know about the most important king of the dynasty, king or kings, his achievements, first king and the last king. Last king is mostly not that very important, because last king means the dynasty is coming to an end. So he was defeated by whom? That's all. I hope that is clear. I hope that is clear and we can move on. Any doubts in this portion? Okay, great. Next, we have terminologies. So for terminologies, we have, this is another important area. For example, 2019, you had Vishti. Now, this is not a new trend. In 2018, 17, 16, they always ask terminology. This is a favorite area of UPSC. 2021 did not have, but it's a favorite area. So for this, there are two things that are very important when it comes to terminologies. First is 2 to 3 things. They will ask terminologies which are related to the socio-economic framework of any dynasty. Can be about some social practice like Vishti, which is forced labor. Can be about name of some tax, some land tax, land revenue and trade. These were the only two, so mostly the most important sources of income for the dynasties, for the kings those days. So any term related to land revenue, any term related to trade is very, very important. Apart from that, different offices held by different people, again, is very important. That is important in case of ancient and medieval both. So offices held by different people, that is very important. Some term, for example, some name of an irrigation wheel, Araghatta or something, came in 2016. So that was important because it's related to irrigation, which is again, it's an economic activity. So you have to look for terms, and your NCRT, don't ignore your NCRTs when it comes to looking for these ancient, people break their head over Krishna Reddy and Upinder Singh and all these things, but they ignore their NCRTs. Don't ever do that. That is a very, very big mistake. Please focus on the terminologies of NCRT and Tamil Nadu book as well. NCRT is made by the government, so it is the most reliable source of information. No two ways about it. So in case of terminologies, important things I'll again sum up. Terms related to some social practice, anything related to society. For example, your Vish, your Jana, your Kula, all these things of the Rig Vedic period related to society or any social practice. Related to the economy, trade and your sea-bound trade or other kinds of land trade and land revenue. Also the names of important offices. These are very, very important. Apart from that, you have those very, very difficult terms of Buddhism, Jainism, that part. That is again a part of covered under Buddhism and Jainism, which is the most favorite area of UPSC, one of the most favorite. So we'll cover that separately, but it also comes in terminology, that when it comes to terminologies, you have to have these important terminologies from Buddhism, Jainism, different practices, different names of different things that they observe, different fast or whatever, their holy temples and everything, all these different practices. Religious practices, names of religious practices is also important. Any difficult name of any religious practice is very, very important. Not only Jainism, Buddhism, other religions, small sects and all these things, that is important. So for that, my suggestion would be, I hope all of you use the desktop or the laptop. So open an Excel sheet, just write in the first column name of the word that you come across. Leave one gap in about which time it was used, during which dynasty's time, what it means, and it is related to what? Like, is it a social practice? or is it related to something, some kind of economic institution? Because questions can come from like that also. So this is how you can go about with terminologies. And as you read, whenever you're reading something, keep that Excel sheet open and keep adding, but only adding will not help. You also have to revise. So please revise. You can revise it every now and then. So it's just revise. Revision is very, very important. That's the only way you can go about. It's as you see, Kulya Vapa and Drona Vapa. Okay. Cultural history, see again, important terminologies. Parivrajaka, Shramana, and Upasaka. Another thing is always try to look for the root word. Parivrajaka. Parivrajak is someone who wanders. I don't know if anyone knows Sanskrit here. It's a Sanskrit word, I guess, because Bengali is a root language of Bengali comes from Sanskrit. A lot of it is derived from Sanskrit. And here in Bengali, we have a word which is known as Parivrajak. Anyone Bengali? I don't know. Any Bengali here? So try to look for the root word. Okay. So you mat kritika, right? So Parivrajak is a word which means a wanderer in Bengali. So try looking for the root word. For example, Shramana Upasaka, someone who does Upasana. I think Upasana Ghar is a prayer hall. Many places, if you go to visit, there these things are written. So try to look for the root word. Just try to look for the root word. That is the way to go about. In case of terminologies, sometimes don't try to be over ambitious and try to guess. If you know the root word, you have a hunch, okay, Upasaka can mean this, then only. Don't, try to, okay, I'll be very innovative. I'll be super innovative and I'll try for the root word and a root word and I'm gonna crack this up. I am the detective or something like that. No, don't try making such wild guesses. It doesn't work in ancient history. Kulya Vapa and Drona Vapa. If you have an idea that, okay, maybe Vapa, Drona Vapa, Kula Vapa, all these things, maybe it's related to something. I have an idea of the word Vapa. Vapa means to sow and all these things. Only then you can guess. Otherwise, no. Just like that, no. Not advisable. Paramitas. Another, see, Jainism and related to Buddhism. Earliest Dharma Shastras, philosophical schools for affections whose attainment led to the Bodhisattva path and all these things. So, see again, try looking for the root word. Paramitas, we have the Pragya Paramita and all these things. So, Paramita basically means someone who's learned or someone who has achieved a kind of perfection. Earliest Dharma Shastra texts were written in, if they were known paramitas, you would have read it somewhere. Philosophical schools, if they were not called paramitas, you would have certainly read it somewhere. That such kind of philosophical schools who did not accept the authority were these Lokvatas and all these things. If paramita was so prominent, it would have been written in your culture book or any other source that you're following. So that's how you have to go about. Try looking for the root word. Next trend. As I said, land revenue and trade, two most important areas of the ancient economy. So see ports and trade routes. See 2017. Which of the following was a very important seaport of the Kakatiya kingdom? They are not asking very mainstream dynasties, tell you. And Kakatiyas and all are coming early medieval dynasty. So early medieval dynasty, because that is again a time of after the Cholas, again a time of very hodgepodge. So whenever they are asking questions from times where there is a hodgepodge of dynasties, because that is where you're going to get confused. Understand the mindset. They want to see how you don't get confused, how stable-headed you are. So it's because it's an exam of elimination. Vacancies are only 700 around. Probably number of people recruited would be less. So somewhere they have to eliminate. So again, important seaport in Kakatiya kingdom. Name of ports are important. each dynasty make a list of ports. Gupta ports, very, very important. Any dynasty which had, now again, don't break your head over, I have to look for ports of every dynasty. Mauryan dynasty, I read research paper after paper to look for names of ports. Not required. You don't know, they might not even ask. So don't spend too much on a topic. Read a page, see ports of Mauryan dynasty. If you have a curiosity, go for or read about Mauryan dynasty or something. Go to Wikipedia, Google it up. One or two pages you read. If find reference to any seaport, anything. If don't, then that dynasty's seaport is not significant. There are dynasties whose trade was significant. Chola's trade was significant. Gupta trade was significant. So these are fine. And also dynasties who were ruling in the coastal, who were there in the coastal areas, their ports would be important. So those kind of ports, you just have to make a list. See, Ghantasala, Chol. Again, go for the word Chol. Battle of Chol, which took place in in the western, on the coastal western coast of India. You've read about the Battle of Chol with the Dutch, probably with the Portuguese. You had the Battle of Chol. So again, try reading the words. If Ghantasala and is not known to you, see if you know any word which is known to you. Maybe you've read it somewhere. Maybe even capitals of powerful kingdoms, if you had read about it, then maybe you would have read about Ghantasala. Ghantasala might seem that it's the capital of a kingdom, where people get confused. But don't just stick to one word. If you are having a very remote idea of someone, then of some word, then go for the next word. See if there is any analogy. Okay, this is about your third trend, fourth trend, your foreign travelers. This year also, you had a question on Noonie. Started in 2018, you had this question on Tavernier. You have this chapter in class 7 NCRT history where it's on travelers, foreign travelers. Now, you might say that everything is not there. Everything is not given there. No, everything will not be given there. So you have to take the basic idea from your NCRT. Know the names of the traveler. And I would suggest just Google it up. What kind of information, which again, you can make a list. You can make a listicle. Like I said, A4 size paper. Name of the traveler, which country he came from, during which king's time period he came. What was the, which century, 13th century, 14th century, which century. Where he visited, which kingdom's king thing he visited, as I already said. And what were his observations? Important ones. Very, very important ones, and which makes him different from the other. And what was his profession? If you get any information, say someone was a diamond trader, other was a doctor or something like that. You don't have too many. You don't have too many of these travelers. So maybe a 10, 15 of them. So you can make this list. You can also make it on an Excel sheet. So that's a good way to go about. So you don't go break your head over names of travelers who are not significant. The basic information, the basic book for study, the basic book of reference is always NCRT 6 to 12. Now UPSC is building on that. So you take the basic information and just Google it up. Just read one page. Spend 10 minutes maximum 10 to 15 minutes, not more than that. Don't read research, don't download research papers, don't go to scholar.google and download research papers. No, that's a detrimental thing to do. See, this is a question. And Vijayanagar, very, very important when it comes to travelers. That time period is very, very important. Vijayanagar is important in every aspect, every aspect. Next, trend 5, Mauryan art and architecture. This is a very favorite area of UPSC ever since. It's always important. Titles of kings, Ashokan titles, Ranno Ashoka. You have to make a list of, you can again take the Excel sheet route, make a list of titles. Now you're already doing the genealogy of kings. So already you have this ready. So once that is done, this kind of questions will be a cakewalk. Inscriptions. Here again, you have to apply your you know, something that is written in your inscriptions. This came in 2020. Now, the smart way to go about is, Samudragupta was a conqueror. And here it's saying that whoever praises his religion or blames other sects out of excessive devotion, he injures his own sect. So this is a very liberal thing, a very, you know, a liberal message that he's trying to go about. He's not at all someone who's dogmatic or who's very orthodox. Samudragupta, who was a conqueror, unlikely that he will give such an, he was mostly, they were Hindu kings. They were followers of, they had Brahminical leanings. So unlikely that they will give such a statement. Harshavardhana, maybe, because he was also a liberal. But before that, you have someone, someone who had a lot of realization after your Kalinga war. Go by that kind of thing, and you can go for Ashoka. So that's how to go about with such kind of questions. Anyone's mic is on. Please switch it off. Please mute yourself. It's causing some kind of a disturbance. Kindly mute yourself. Okay, great. Thank you. Next trend, trend 6, is your Indus Valley and Rigvedic. This is okay. Any doubts till now? Any questions? Any doubts? You can quickly type in the chat box if you have any questions, any doubts. Nahida, yeah, please. Clear. Okay. Trend 5, not clear. What was trend 5, by the way? Mauryan art and architecture. Mauryan art is related to, the time period of Mauryas. Whatever architecture was built, these caves, architecture or Ashokan inscriptions. So you have to by heart these inscriptions, which inscription has what? What is the message in all these things? These are just by heart. To be by hearted, you can make a table and just know. Also, you can have some mnemonics, like inscription 13 is about your Kalinga war. So 412 is about that. So you can have some kind of poem or some mnemonic to just remember what is related to what. Or, Kangan Hali, what was there? Where is, you can also have a quick, NCRT has this map. You can draw it in your hand in your notes that, where is Manshera? Where is Shabaz Gari? Where is your Kangan Hali? Kangan Hali is in Karnataka. They are outside India. So if you'll have an idea of where these places are, now you can just Google it up. And just write it. Shabaz Gari is in present day Afghanistan. Kangan Hali is in present day Karnataka. All such kind of things. And this is also relevant. Also very, very relevant for your different Mesolithic, Neolithic and your Paleolithic sites. Just draw a quick map which place it's located. And it's very beautifully given in your Tamil Nadu book and your NCRT. So you just replicate that map with your own hand and just know which state or which district of that state. I think that is more than enough. District is not even required. At least which part of the state? Southern Tamil Nadu or Northern Tamil Nadu? That is enough. Hindi. Tamil Nadu books up to which standard? 11 and 12. Hindi mein. How many wanted in Hindi? Okay, I'll switch over to Hindi. Actually, there are people who don't understand Hindi, people down south. Okay. Okay, Nahida, aapko, I'm following NCRT, not Tamil Nadu. Should I read that? You just read, these trends that I'm saying and how to go about. If any piece of information you're not getting in your NCRT, then go for Tamil Nadu. Don't repeat the same information. Ek hi cheez ko bar bar, reading from multiple books. Isse koi fayda nahi hai. If you get any new piece of information, toh theek hai, toh kar lo. But cheezo ko, matlab, zyada phailana, sources ko zyada phailana nahi hai. That will create a problem. Sources should be restricted. enough for ancient, you're also having your NCRTs. Make it a combination of both. Make it a combination of both. But again, एक ही चीज को मल्टीपल बुक से पढ़ने का कोई फायदा नहीं है. ओनली अगर फॉर एग्जाम्पल यू आपने अशोकन इंस्क्रिप्शंस के बारे में अबाउट दीज 13 इंस्क्रिप्शंस और योर ऑल दीज इंस्क्रिप्शंस यस 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 हिंदी में भी ओके ओके या श्योर श्योर आई एम ट्राइंग एंड बीइंग बाइलिंगुअल ओके समा सेइंग इंग्लिश समा सेइंग हिंदी आई विल ट्राई एंड बी बाइलिंगुअल तो एक ही मॉडर्न व्हील डील इन अ सेपरेट सेशन सागर स्पेक्ट्रम शुड बी इनफ देखो ज्यादा बुक से पढ़ने के तुम तो मैं आई कैन रेफर टू यू 10 बुक्स उससे फायदा क्या है टाइम इज वेरी शॉर्ट और एक हिस्ट्री में आपको मास्टर बन के तो प्रिलिम्स आपका क्लियर होने वाला नहीं है यू हैव टू बी गुड इन अदर थिंग्स ऑल्सो यू हैव सो स्मार्ट अप्रोच इज नीडेड अगर कोई क्वेश्चन होगा तो आपको वो स्पेक्ट्रम से ही हो जाएगा अगर नहीं होगा तो नहीं होगा तो किसी का भी नहीं होगा दीज टॉपर्स एंड एवरीथिंग दे आर स्टडिंग स्पेक्ट्रम ओनली आई थिंक इट्स मोर इम्पोर्टेंट दैट यू सॉल्व मोर एमसीक्यूज इंस्टेड ऑफ जस्ट यू नो रीडिंग फ्रॉम मल्टीपल बुक्स यस ओके 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 सागर Great. So this is how you can go about. Apart from that, you can, as I said about these inscriptions, you can make your own diagram. Just usko replicate kar lena. NCRTs mein jo diagrams diya ho, usko replicate kar lena and just write it down. Like make an arrow, put a map, draw in a sheet of paper. Say Kanganhalli is in Karnataka. Which part of Karnataka? Type it on Google, Kanganhalli. साउदर्न कर्नाटका नॉर्दर्न कर्नाटका विच पार्ट ऑफ कर्नाटका विच डिस्ट्रिक्ट बस उसके मैप में एक एरो डालो कंगनहल्ली एंड राइट इट इन अ ब्रैकेट दैट्स हाउ यू गो अबाउट ज्यादा पढ़ना नहीं है बट जितना पढ़ना है सॉलिड पढ़ना है बेकार की चीजें मत पढ़ो अगेन हरप्पन साइट्स वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एज आई सेड योर Paleolithic, Mesolithic, 2020 में क्वेश्चन नहीं आया 21 में नहीं आया 22 में आ भी सकता है सो यू कैन हैव अ क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम योर हरप्पन साइट्स और हरप्पन यू हैड अ क्वेश्चन धोलावीरा बट इट वॉज प्रीटी इजी बिकॉज सी अगेन यूपीएससी ट्रिक ऑल ऑफ अस एवरीवन वाज रीडिंग डूइंग अ लॉट ऑफ रिसर्च ऑन धोलावीरा Because Dholavira became a UNESCO site. So they gave the most easy question on Dholavira. So that's how UPSC is going to trick you. If UPSC and every institute, everybody is going to make difficult questions, was making difficult questions on Dholavira. Because everyone knew that it's in news. But UPSC is also deviating from that trend that if it's in news, you're going to get questions, very difficult questions from there. So you read in detail. Okay. So, which of the following is not a Harappan site, as I said? So, again, for this Harappan sites, uska bhi ek, like the same strategy aapko follow karna. Ki aap map banao, usko likho kaun kahan, like kaun si site kahan par hai. To automatically aapko pata chal jayega ki kaun si Gujarat mein hai aur kaun si UP mein hai, kaun si out of India hai. Rivers. उसके थ्रू कौन सी रिवर्स फ्लो करता है किसने डिस्कवर किया ये भी इंपॉर्टेंट है तो इसका भी आप एक एक्सेल शीट बना सकते हो हालांकि बहुत से बुक्स में दिया हुआ है इफ यू वांट टू पुट एवरी ऑल इंफॉर्मेशन इन वन पेज देन जस्ट राइट साइट अगेन मेक एन A4 शीट साइट प्लेस और द स्टेट मॉडर्न स्टेट एक्सक्यूज मी डिस्ट्रिक्ट सॉरी स्टेट River which flows through it, who discovered it, and year. Ab year mein aapko, it is 1953 or 1954, ye aapko yaad nahi karna hai for UPSC. But you have to know that whether it's pre-independence or post-independence. If post-independence, then in which era? 90s era, 80s era, 50s era, which era? Kisne kiya? For kisne kiya, again, you can make a mnemonic or something like that. And kisne kiya for, you know, for some important sites are important. You don't have to mug up so many names. Again, Rigvedic. Rigvedic Aryans and Indus Valley people. Ye bhi 2017 ka ek question hai. This question is from 2017. So this is about features of Rigvedic. We already do that. Your books can also be important. This year they gave a book, from Jainism and Buddhism, Jain playwrights. They gave some names. So you can see that in ancient and medieval history, ye Excel sheet jaisa format or A4 sheet mein jo ek list banate ho. So this list based thing is one to go about because they are asking 2-3 things and saying, what is the common thing between them? Who are these people? So they are asking that kind of analogical questions in history, in ancient and medieval history. Here they are asking some features. This was in 2017. So automatically, this portion becomes important, but we all go about doing this. Which kind, which portion. Now, this is also important because don't think that UPSC will not ever ask. This was in 2017, might be in 2022. So, us hisab se, we cannot leave anything in ancient and medieval history, but we have to take a smart approach. You cannot go about, breaking your head over big, heavy books. You have to take a smart approach. So, where they use mail and helmet, all these coat of mail and helmet, all these things. Again, you have to use elimination. So, isme to koi special strategy hai nahi. Rigveda mein, you can just make a list of the Vedas. What are their Brahmanas? What are their Aranyakas? And all the what are their Upanishads? Which period, which was there? Kind of priests in each. So, what you do is Rigveda, their ancillary books, Aranyaka, Upanishads, and your Brahmanas. Apart from that, Rigvedic priest was called something. What was the Upaveda of Rigveda? All these things you can make a list in an Excel sheet because all these are small, small words. You can type it out in your laptop. You don't have to write so much. But for big things, I would suggest make your physical notes. Write on a piece of paper. Because sometimes on an Excel sheet, typing and then, that becomes difficult. Reading it from there. Because your column starts expanding. Next trend, Buddhism and Jainism. Buddhism, Jainism is the next trend, which is again a very, very favorite area of UPSC. You can have questions from literally anything out here. Future Buddha, as I said, important terms. See, who among the following was a future Buddha? Names of different, playwrights or names of different the people. Associated names of priests, literature of this period. So another list that you can make is literature, different books, who wrote them and during which king and which dynasty. Another list in the Excel sheet. Different. So you basically have to make these 5-6 lists and your history is done. When you revise before your exam, you'll see it's so, so easy. And now, don't make the list and just keep it saved. You have to revise it again and again. And just make it a practice. Like, it should be like, it's not like now I will sit to revise your Excel sheet. Not like that. It should be a practice. So, on ancient things and different, different, these court of Chandragupta, it had different people. So, who was Charak? Who was Shushrut? He was a contemporary of whom? What was his profession? So all these things also you can put in that books and authors thing. Listicle. Next we come to out of the box questions. So out of the box questions are questions that we are totally unprepared and we don't know whether they are following any trend. Probably it doesn't follow any trend. For example, this year's question on Mitakshara. It's a law book we all know. But Dayabhaga, very few people have known. What are their special features? 90% people did not know. So these are called out-of-the-box questions. So what you do is how to go about with this is whenever you come across a term in your NCRT and your Tamil Nadu book, mostly in NCRT. Mitakshara was there, very much there in NCRT, but not in detail. Maybe Dayabhaga was also there, but not in detail. So what you do is, whenever you come across anything, any word, maybe it's in some corner, in a box, under a picture, underline that. Just go to Google and read 5 minutes, you know, one page on that. What is it about? What if it's some name of some architectural structure? What is it? Who built it? Or something like that. It's some book. It's some treatise. And what is it? It is about what? It was used by whom? It was built during which period? It was written during which period? So that's the only way to go about. And just try to incorporate it in your notes. That's the only way to go about with such. UPSC will never ask any word which is not there in your NCERT. But what you have to do is, it builds on it. UPSC will build on that. So UPSC will try to ask you statements which are confusing. They'll give you statements which are confusing, which are not directly from the book. But the concept is there in the book. The word is there in the book. But whatever information UPSC is giving on that word, that all of it might not be covered in that book. So for that, you have to do that extra hard work. I hope that is clear. Any questions? Source for Jainism and Buddhism? Same. Your ancient, your current NCERTs, your previous NCERTs. Which NCERT? I don't remember. Gauri, I don't remember. Mitakshara was certainly there. Next, we'll go to any questions up till now? Then we'll move on to trends on medieval. Any questions? Any questions, any doubts till now? Any doubts, anybody else? Great. Okay, everything clear. So let's move on. Now we'll move on to your Sultanate and your Mughal period. So for medieval, you have your Sultanate, you have your Mughals, then you have your Marathas and that period, Shivaji and the Marathas and that period. That is all about your medieval. Medieval is relatively less. And there are certain things where medieval, certain things of medieval that are very important. Wars. Directly, we don't have questions till now. But again, don't ignore it. As I said, make the genealogy of kings, chronology, and include wars in that. That will be easier that way. Important terminologies, yes. Medieval, different offices. Again, economic and social practices, if any. Early medieval economic and social practices is very, very important. From your Sultanate and your Mughals, social practices, if you find any, not much are there. Economic, if you have any, yes, names of taxes and different offices. Who was the Diwani Ards and what was Diwani Insha and Mumallik and all these things, you know, who were the Barids, all these terminologies are important. So this year also you had a question on Pargana, Suba. So these economic divisions, these administrative divisions is again very, very important. Would be important for ancient medieval both. And religious reformers. Here you need the chronology. Again, you have to make a list. Religious reformers. And then you have the land revenue system. In the medieval system, Mughals, the most important thing was the land revenue. They had done great amount of work, great amount of innovation they brought about in land revenue. So land revenue becomes a very, very important area. So you have to know in detail about the features. What was Ikta, what was Jagir, what was Mansabdar, what was Du Aspa, Si Aspa, what was the difference? That you have to know conceptually. What was the Sikandari Gaza, what was the Jarib and all these things? That you have to know in detail because this was the most, this was the area where they had brought about most amount of innovation. Also in architecture will also, you will also have to see the different features, but that comes in the culture part. See, Jagirdari and Zamindari, what were the differences? So as I said, you have to know about features of that, features of different systems, Jagirdari, Zamindar, everything. And then you can do. And these here, you mostly have multi-statement questions where you need in-depth knowledge. Otherwise, not possible. Names of different offices, Amil, Ikta, Mir Bakshi. When did the which office come into being? This is again important. So if you are having any, you know, you are making this king genealogy, and if it doesn't fit in that Excel sheet, just add one word, and later when you write about these offices, make a list of these offices, give a reference of that, you know, that sheet, that A4 sheet. So maybe, you know, Diwani Bandgan, Department of Slaves, came up during a particular king of the Sultanate period. So when you have that, when you're writing about that king, just write in that Diwani Bandgan came into being. Later on, when you're writing in this notes of, you know, which terminologies, there you write that further information in that sheet. So you have Diwani Bandgan is Department of Slaves, put a bracket and write further information in file, history file, page so and so. And page numbering is very, very important. Always have a page number whenever you're putting loose sheets in your file. So indexing is very, very important. Give feature example in history. I did not get your question, Mary. Could you just be a little more clear? Could you just be a little more clear what you're asking? I did not get your question, my dear. Okay, so let's move on. She has not replied anything. Okay, moving on. So any doubts till now? I can't say another word. You can unmute yourself and you can say. Feature example, I do not understand. What does that mean? Okay, then let's move on. Again, different administrative divisions, Pargana, Suba, all these things. Pargana, Suba, all these things, these are important. Administrative divisions, very, very important. You have to know, here you can again make a flowchart kind of a thing. When you're doing administrative divisions, first comes your Pargana, first comes your Suba, then comes your Sarkar or Pargana or whatever be the sequence. You can do like that, flowchart kind of thing. This session, that you can contact, you can ping at Diademy and you can know about the details of course and everything. Okay, Nahida, Diademy ke jo Twitter, jo Telegram handle is, agar milti hai to, we'll post it on the Telegram channel, jahan se aapko link mila hai na, we'll post it, PDF. और क्लास के बारे में जो डिटेल्स जो वगैरह है जो आप डायडमी के टेलीग्राम हैंडल पे आप पिंग कर लेना वहां आपको सारी इंफॉर्मेशन दी जाएगी. नेक्स्ट सी अगेन क्रोनोलॉजी बेस्ड. यस यस या मयूरी श्योर. इट वाज ड्यूरिंग द रेन ऑफ इल्तुतमिश. सी पीपीटी में ज्यादा कुछ है नहीं, ट्रेंड्स है, लेकिन सिर्फ PPT से फायदा नहीं है. तुम सुनो मेरी बात, जो भी मैं बोल रही हूँ ना, because very little information is there on the PPT. Most of it I'm covering, I'm telling, speaking it out. ये सब previous year questions है. ज़्यादा कुछ information है नहीं, but we'll still post the PPT. Don't worry. This is again a chronology based question. Chronology-based question. During the reign of Iltutmish, the Genghis Khan, if you do that chronology of kings, this part is done. Who attacked during which time? Whose war during? So not directly wars are being asked. not directly wars are being, see how indirectly it was during the reign of Iltutmish, Genghis Khan reached, during the reign of Muhammad bin Tughlaq, Taimur occupied. Now, Taimur did not occupy during Muhammad bin Tughlaq. It was after, after Muhammad bin Tughlaq. So even less important kings are important. After Muhammad bin Tughlaq, we read about Firoz Tughlaq and then we are done with it. But less important kings, because it is important because Taimur attacked, occupied Multan then. So you have to make, and that was the last king. Last kings are also very, very important. First king, last king. In the Sultanate period, you cannot miss any king. Mostly, you cannot miss kings. Again, Vijayanagar, very, very important area. Vijayanagar would be important from the perspective of, different travelers that came. The systems, military system, the Nayankara system that they had, which is very, very important. The details of that system, these Nayakas that they had. Later on, these Nayakas were their feudatories and you had the Nayaka kings who built the Memnakshi temple. They were actually the feudatories or the military chiefs of these Vijayanagar kings. And different kings, they were very culturally enriched people. Vijayanagar ke jo kings the, wo culturally, wo bahut sound the, very culturally inclined the. Unhone bahut sare temples banaye hain, jaise, Virupaksh temple and all these things. Kuch un log ke local deities the. And art, architecture, different, Krishnadevaraya had a coat of eight or nine gems. Alasani Pedana and Tengali Ramakrishna, all these people were there. So and he wrote a number of books, Amukta Malayada, all these things, books he wrote. So these would be very important. And the only way to cover it is make a listicle. Next, you have your religious reformers. Who is, Sufi and Bhakti. These were the most important movements that were taking place. Bhakti or Sufi, maybe aap list banao, Excel sheets banao. Kaise? Take the name of the reformer. Which period? Which century? Which king? He was a Nirguna or a Saguna? If Saguna, then believer of which? Krishna or Rama? And what was his main belief? What did he focus on? And which area? Whether it's UP or whether it's South India or which area. As it, put it in one sheet. All information in one sheet, chota chota karke. Make a Excel sheet. And you keep revising. History bowl cake folder banao in your laptop. Put all these Excel sheets there. And you keep revising. That's the only way to go about. Same thing for Sufi saints. Bhakti and Sufi, to make two different things. Also make sure that any Sufi saint who is contemporary of any Bhakti saint, that information should also be there. If you have any such information. Again, reference to Mia Tansen, this is about the Mughal period. All your, these, the cultural part, the, who were these nine gems of Akbar's court, about them. So this culture, art and culture part is very important. People, about these people, these Tansen and Birbal and all these people, their different titles, their lives. So you can just Google it up. Again, Mughal paintings is very, very important. Which king had what, fetish for these. Mughal art and architecture itself is very, very important. So that's all about the trends. And about the suggested book list, as I said, NCERTs, I forgot to include the Tamil Nadu book names. But Tamil Nadu 11 and 12, NCERT 6 to 12. Krishna Reddy, Upinder Singh, A.L. Basham, not a necessity. If you want to do your extra, you know that you are very confident in other subjects and you want to do extra research and extra things and all in all that. Or if history is your optional, then you have to read such books. Other than that, just not required. And another thing is the Diademic Prelims Booster History Notes, where you get a compilation of everything. Everything that I said. History Notes mein sab kuch hai. It's a compilation made using your NCERTs and Tamil Nadu. It's a one-stop destination. Iske alawa, you don't need to refer to your NCERTs and do all these hard work again. If you refer to these notes. And tips and tricks. Solving MCQs, previous year questions, repeated revision and terminologies, chronology charts. So that's all. That's all about your history. That was about decoding your ancient and medieval history. I hope it's clear. Any doubts?
Yes, ma'am. This is Gauri. I have a doubt.
Yes.
With respect to this Bhakti saints and Sufi saints. Actually, I made a map and I was doing that way. So in the books, like if someone is at 15th century, so we cannot say now that whether he was in early 15th century or later 15th century, then how to identify?
In the book, it's not there early 15th or late 15th.
No, like it was given.
Time period, only 15th century is there. Which book are you referring to?
I think I refer to Nitin Singhania's book.
Okay. If you don't have it, then look up your NCRTs and your Nitin Singhania's book is on culture. So that will not have too much of on your historical timeline information. So you can refer to your NCRT or your Tamil Nadu book for these, the history part of it. Cultural part is different.
Okay.
But for the Bhakti Sufi sense, only referring to Nitin Singhania sir's book is not enough.
I read entire culture from there only. So
yes, you read it. That's a very, very good book, very authentic source. But the Bhakti Sufi entirely from there will not be covered. You have to refer to NCRT or Tamil Nadu. Or best, if you don't find that information, anything, say you're looking up for, you know, Kabir.
Hmm.
For that matter, just type Kabir and read the Wikipedia page, like which king he was.
I don't use Google much.
Okay.
So, okay, ma'am, I'll just...
Google comes handy. Yeah.
But
Google comes handy actually at times. Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. I'll do that because that was the problem I was facing. How to identify contemporaries.
So different books have different focus areas. Nitin Singhania sir's book on culture. So that book has focused on the culture part. History part of it, have to refer to your NCRT.
Okay. For example, I'll give you one example. Like Eknath. Eknath is in 16th century, right? So,
yes.
How to identify who was in... So I can tell in 16th century, Babur was also there, Akbar was also there, right? So I get confused.
So you know the exact time. That's why you need the exact date. Then you can understand he was a contemporary of Babur or Akbar. He was born in, after 1556. Say he was around Eknath. I don't know. I don't remember Eknath's time period right now. Say it's around 1580. And he was a contemporary of Akbar.
Okay. So, I'll check it in NCRT and Tamil Nadu.
Right.
Thank you, ma'am.
Any other question? Take a session on modern India. Yeah, we'll see about it. We'll surely have one session on modern India as well. Chinta Deepika, yes, what's your question?
Ma'am, what are the sources for the ancient and medieval? Is it enough for the NCRT books or under
NCRT? And did you join just now?
No, ma'am, from the first only, but the voice was not clear at the end of the session.
Okay. See, your NCRT 6 to 12 and Tamil Nadu books are a necessity. You have to do that. But from that, I don't recommend any other book, but you have to take on smart reading. You have to use the internet for some additional information. And, you have to follow how I told you, I suggested certain, I discussed certain trends and suggested how to go about making making charts and all these things.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Apart from that, I don't think for prelims, you need to cover, 10 books. That's not required, actually.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Nahida. Yes. Question kya hai? Haan, batao, Nahida, what's your question? Okay. Any other doubts, any other queries?
मैम हेलो
यस
मैम, मेरे क्लासमेट जो है वो बोलते हैं कि जो मॉडर्न इंडिया वाली बुक है स्पेक्ट्रम, बोलते हैं वो रेफर करो और आर्ट एंड कल्चर, तो और बोलते हैं कि जो आप ये मेडिवल पढ़ रहे हैं तो वो आप मत पढ़ें।
आई आई डोंट सजेस्ट मीडियवल मत पढ़ो ऐसा आई डोंट नो मतलब
मैम बोलते हैं कि मेडिवल से कम क्वेश्चन आते हैं, आर्ट एंड कल्चर से आते हैं और मॉडर्न इंडिया से आते हैं।
ऐसे बहुत से लोग होंगे दे आर गोइंग टू से अ लॉट ऑफ थिंग्स अगर मतलब ये आपको डिसाइड करना है कि आपको आप खुद ट्रेंड देखो ना डोंट गो सी एनीबडीज ब्लाइंडली फॉलो एनीबडीज एडवाइस खुद ट्रेंड देखो आप ये जो मैंने सेशन लिया है जो पीपीटी मैंने दिखाई है जो आप ये तो सारे प्रीवियस ईयर के क्वेश्चंस है मैंने ट्रेंड एनालाइज किया और उसके सपोर्टिंग में जो प्रीवियस ईयर के क्वेश्चंस आए हैं लास्ट 3-4 इयर्स में वही दिखाए हैं तो तुम
जी
खुद
मैम
ये देखो इसको फॉलो करके देखो किसी की बातों पे क्यों ऐसे ब्लाइंडली
हाँ
करना
मैम, एक बात मैम, और जैसे कि मैं आपको ये बोलूंगी कि आपने कब से ये मतलब मीटिंग शुरू की है, मतलब इसका कोई पीडीएफ वगैरह मिलेगा जो मतलब मैंने नहीं ज्वाइन किया है।
नहीं ये तो एक फ्री सेशन है तो इसका वैसे पीडीएफ शायद हम टेलीग्राम चैनल पे जो डायडमी का मेन चैनल है उस पे पोस्ट कर देंगे और इफ यू वांट यू नो रिकॉर्डेड क्लासेस एंड योर पीपीटीज एंड एवरीथिंग अबाउट द यू नो अबाउट द लाइक ऑन हिस्ट्री एंड एवरीथिंग देन आई यू हैव द प्रीलिम्स बूस्टर कोर्स तो आप डायडमी के जो यू नो जिसको जो टेलीग्राम हैंडल है उस पर एक पिंग कर लो कि आपको जो भी कोर्स चाहिए होंगे कि आप बता दो कि कुछ भी पिंग कर लो जो भी आपको पूछना है एंड एवरीथिंग विल बी टोल्ड टू यू यस
जी मैम, थैंक यू मैम।
एनी अदर क्वेश्चन मैम प्रीलिम्स बूस्टर नोट्स इज व्हिच गिवन आफ्टर जॉइन कोर्स और बिफोर प्रीलिम्स कोर्स ये तुम्हारा जो भी कन्वीनियंट है जो भी है तुम एक जो टेलीग्राम हैंडल है उस पर पिंग कर लो
जी मैम, जी मैम।
नो दिस इज नॉट फॉर यू दिस नाहिदा दिस इज फॉर मिथुला समवन आस्क्ड एनी क्वेरी रिगार्डिंग कोर्स प्लीज पिंग ऑन द टेलीग्राम हैंडल ऑफ डायडमी इट्स गिवन इन देयर मेन द चैनल दैट यू हैव
गुड आफ्टरनून मैम।
यस
मैम, वी नीड टू कवर मॉडर्न हिस्ट्री फ्रॉम कवर टू कवर, और कैन वी गो अलोंग विद इवेंट्स कवरिंग इन सीक्वेंस?
See, this session was not on modern history. This was on ancient and medieval. When we come up with a session on modern history, then we'll definitely tell you how decode trends and tell you how to go about.
ओके मैम।
And I will say that again, you have to take a very smart approach in reading modern history. Just going cover to cover blindly will not help. You have to know the trends, know the areas, and what kind of questions are asked. Nitin Singhania is very bulky, so how can we learn all small details? See, you have to follow these trends, and your art and culture book is the Nitin Singhania book that you are having. So you follow these trends, try to plug in information from that book into these trends. Art and culture, we might have a separate session. This was on ancient and medieval. Then we can go about with that. If for history and ancient medieval history, the only way to go about with mugging such, you cannot go about opening books and mugging information from that. You have to some kind of tables or something like that. So this is the only way you can go about and revision. Please tell the chronology of these three empires. My dear, I'm not teaching history now. I'm not teaching history now. This was only on the trend. They were all Chola Cheras and Pandyas, they were more or less ruling during the same time, and that was the Sangam age. Any other question? Any other question? I guess no other question. Okay, then. I hope the session was useful. I hope it was useful. It provided some kind of value addition to you. Okay. Thank you. Thanks. It was great for me too. Thank you. Thank you, guys.